that's the opposite of the angle. This is the adjacent side to this angle. The cosine is... I got blue on, so... I guess already. The cosine of theta is the ratio, is the adjacent to the hypotenuse. So the cosine of theta, whatever this angle is, it'll always have a constant ratio of this side length to this side length. This being the hypotenuse of our right triangle. So that's going to be V initial over X over V. V initial. And of course, we, yet again, we simply multiply these two, and we're left with whatever this value is. So
essay.
direction of motion the gravity would focus would affect that ball in is the up and downward motion. So if gravity's going downwards, oh, you know what? I forgot the camera. So if the ball's going this way, gravity's going downwards, it's only going to affect the ball in the up and down direction. The horizontal component is not affected, so there's no gravity. And then therefore, this whole part can be excluded because it's zeroed out, because gravity is zero in the x direction. And we're left with, or simply left with, the change in x, which we're going to call r, because that's what we're trying to get. They just renamed in this equation. We're trying to get this equation that says the range of the projectile starting with this velocity shot at this angle is going to be equal to all that. So the range is simply the distance it traveled from here to here, assuming that, of course, it ends at the same height as its final as its initial height. I guess the heights are the same, so this won't work. If I kind of misdrew it, if it lands up here, this equation would set that aside and now derive our y component using this. Okay, so using this same equation here, the distance, and this is why this is a pretty crucial puzzle piece that fits it all together, is that for this equation in the y direction, we want the delta y equals the, remember this is in the x direction, so I should have put like a little disclaimer that this is not the same as this, this is the same as this. Sorry about that. Actually able to follow along so far. I just definitely confused you. substitute this for this, so this little value will become sine theta times the initial velocity times time plus 1/2 the acceleration times the value of time squared. Okay, so acceleration again is gravity, and this must just seem like chaos to anyone who isn't familiar with physics, but so bad at just sticking to one train of thought. This is the same as this. It's a value of acceleration. So, and don't worry about the time. We're going to make that disappear through algebra, the magic of algebra. So, the beginning height, the delta y, is just the change. It's just the final height minus the initial height, which is 0 minus 0 minus 0, which equals 0. And this, the initial velocity in the y direction, the initial velocity, remember, is this. So just this is this value here. So we're going to say v naught sine of theta t plus 1/2 times acceleration in the vertical direction is going to be negative because it's going down 9.8. Well, you know what? We'll just leave that as g because we want this tidy equation to be all variables. We want it to look nice and tidy, like E equals MC squared. That equation actually can have numbers in it. C is actually a number, but it looks prettier as just a simple single letter. So G, and then T squared again. We're going to make that disappear, so we're not worried about T. And the magic that we're about to work is two equations right here. So, what I'm going to do, okay, let's see. So, G, so actually what we're going to do is this negative sign out in front and make it negative. Yeah, I guess I won't bother explaining it too much. So for this one, I'm going to find out what this is in terms of all these other variables in this equation. Once I have B naught equals something, I'm going to plug it into here. So we have let's rewrite this real quick. 0 equals V naught sine theta times T. And now we're going to, this G is actually negative 9.8, so I'm going to make that a negative because it's, we don't want to write the number, but we do want to pay attention to the negatives, so it's kind of confusing. We'll just pretend it's the absolute value there. So negative 1/2 G times T squared just simplify this. And it's one step away from being this. Or two steps. Let me simplify it, then I'll do the last step. So we have two V-naught times itself. Just had to get that off my chest. You guys are awesome. And I think after all, all sleep do, and hopefully you guys enjoyed it, I don't know. Do I use the future or past or past tense? Doesn't matter at this point, I suppose. So, get some sleep, guys. And I'll see you next time.
Easy.
got a let's make a little coordinate system. Let's pretend it's the sea, so it should be a little rough anyway. But this. So we have, let's see. Well, you always, I like to always start by writing my knowns, and then we try to figure out which unknowns we need. Said we have to break it into the horizontal, so our initial velocity is 82 meters per second. I guess we can break it up into the x axis and y axis. So the initial x axis would be, the velocity would be, if we have a So if we have a triangle, and maybe I should have drew it a little bigger, but when you have a triangle, or when you have an example like this, and it's not in a perfectly horizontal or vertical orientation, what physics, people of physics of the past have learned to do is break it into its horizontal and vertical components. So, if this is the real trajectory of it, we can break it into an imaginary horizontal and vertical component by saying that this is the velocity, which is 82 meters per second. So this, if we look at it as a right triangle, because that's why we did it, is because we're using this, you know, 2,000-3,000-year-old geometrical and trigonometrical identities and rules, is that to figure out what this would be, I guess I'll write it like this. The initial velocity in the x direction equals the initial velocity in the y direction equals is going to be, you're going to use the sine. Sine is the, represents the opposite magnitude. So, oh sorry, cosine. You have, let's see, I should write it down. Let's see, so, SOHCAHTOA. That means sine represents the opposite over hypotenuse. Hypotenuse. And the cosine, I guess I'll write the whole word out, is the adjacent over hypotenuse. I always go way too, I probably bore you to death and not to sleep by going too far into the background, so I'll just assume you guys understand what sine and cosine are, and if not, then maybe this will just bore you to sleep and hopefully not to death. But if we have to figure out what the horizontal component of this is, actual velocity, which we know is velocity in the x direction. We don't know that, but we do know this is 82 meters per second. And what's interesting about this is that you can use the fact that you don't know what this is to, sorry, I should have said that. It's the cosine of theta equals that, so if we know what the angle is, which we don't actually, we can do cosine of theta actually equals this. So phi, oh, therefore, it was a little therefore symbol. And if you guys are just antsy to find out whether I figured this out or not, maybe skip to the end, because I'm honestly at this point not sure I can figure this out with the given information, because this book is using a specially derived formula for the known information of this problem. So they might not have given us enough information cosine of theta is, we would be able to solve it. Now here we don't know what that is, but we can put that aside as a nice little equation for now. In physics is, if you're going to solve for unknowns, you need at least as many equations, including with that include those unknowns, as the number of unknowns that you have itself. So we have, right now we have three unknowns. We have a velocity in the horizontal direction, the vertical direction, and we have the angle that it did not give us. So we need right now. I'll say that's one equation. Then we have this equation. That's two. And let's see. Self-referential. I don't think that would be too helpful if I said, sine of theta over cosine of theta equals tangent of theta. That wouldn't really help us too much. I think that we can start using these equations. See what we know and we don't know. We do know that the, according to our coordinate system, x initial is 0, x final, the final x, is 560 meters. So that's our delta x, is 560 meters. So we can do something. We can do something with that information. For instance, we could figure out the time. All these will have to be individually applied to the x and the y axis. So we do know that, for instance, in the y direction. Okay, so we know, something I just thought of is that we can divide this distance in half and say that this point is exactly 280 meters. So in the y direction, once we shoot this cannon from here, even though it's going like this, the only force acting upon it is gravity. Gravity, which equals 9.81 meters per second squared. That's gravity, which is also an acceleration. So, what that means. initial velocity that we, again, don't know, but we do know its final velocity once it reaches the peak is, so right here, its initial is, we don't know, but its final, we'll just say the initial is 0, the final is 1, we know is 0 meters per second. Thanks. ratio video. I better not be switching that 1 and that 8. Oh, there we go, 9.8. Okay, that's what gravity is. Okay, so. I know they wouldn't round 9.18 to 9.8, so. I know I got the numbers right. And this is just being a little more specific, accurate. That's units or meters per second squared. And then the change in x is. Just to hear where the velocity hits zero momentarily. Damn, okay. I totally screwed up. We know that horizontally this is 280, but I didn't. I completely missed that. I actually don't know what delta x is. So, I screwed up. But what I can do is, hopefully, maybe I can solve using another equation. Sorry, guys. Okay, well, okay, let's. Maybe I can switch to the horizontal. So we have horizontal velocity won't change. So we know whatever it is, the equals V equals so there are at any point. What's interesting about breaking it up into its horizontal and vertical components is that the horizontal velocity will never change. The only thing that will stop it is when it hits the ground. Of course, remember that we're excluding the real world effects of air resistance, but if you do that, you do exclude that, then this becomes a constant horizontal velocity. The only velocity is the vertical velocity that changes. So we know velocity, and we can figure out time, I suppose. No, I know we can't. Because there's no change. So that would be that plus that. Well, I guess we can figure out the time using this one. We know the distance. This is a third equation we might not ever use, but let's go to this one and use this one as well. Okay, so we have, so V1x squared equals, so I'm going to use this one first, equals V initial V0x squared plus 2a times change in x. because those are the same, times t. Okay, well, I guess that's kind of very obvious. We could have done that in our heads. So that means that t equals delta x over v naught x, which equals, let's find out what it was for 280. So delta x is 280 meters over our v naught x. Okay, so now we have this equation. So that's equation 4. So we have time and our initial. Okay, and acceleration, time. I want to figure out what the time was. We can do okay, I want to try to use this one now. Acceleration. Oh, because there's no acceleration in that direction, so that'll get wiped out. And that's redundant. Okay, so after doing a half hour of research that I should have done, which would have told me to pick a easier damn problem, I'm gonna use the equation I've been avoiding this whole time, apparently. So for the x direction, we have delta x equals, let's rewrite the equation real quick, v naught x d plus 1/2 at squared. So in the x direction, remember there was no acceleration, so a is 0, and getting nulled out by being multiplied by 0, we're left with this equation here, which actually equals, let's see, okay, actually equals, okay, so t, we're left with the fact that t equals delta x over, and remember up here I said that is equal to 82 times cosine of theta. Okay, so we have equation 5 now. And in the y direction, we're going to apply this same equation. And what we have is delta y. And from here, because we know, I guess there's no fancy way of putting it. We know that in the y direction, it goes up, but it comes back down to its exact initial height. You know, it starts up, we pretend that's zero, or, you know, sea level, I guess. It goes up at some distance, it does. Nice little fly ball trajectory, but it does. does end up coming down back to sea level, so it seems weird, but it that means there's no change in the height, and you'll see why that actually works. So again, using this, but we have V naught y this time times t. this done for you, and you just would have had to kind of follow it, understand how you got there, and then recognized, okay, when I'm given a problem with that doesn't have the angle, and you know, when I'm given a problem with certain information and it requires me to find out the angle, that kind of indicates that you should not use these, but you should use the one I'm about to derive for you, that the equation with the angle kind of points you in the right direction. But nonetheless, I'm still getting a little scraping a little rust off the gears here by doing this here. Okay, so we've plugged all our values into this equation. Now let's simplify. And so even though we're breaking this into the horizontal and vertical components, the time it takes to get from here to here, whether you go purely horizontal or purely vertical, is, you know, whether you go right there or whether you go up and back to it, the time it takes is going to be the same. So that's why we were able to use time on in both domains, in both dimensions. So to simplify this, now we recognize that 82 cancels with 82. So maybe I'll use this fancy pen. So we got 82 cancels 82. And that's about it, I guess. So this is just a bunch of me scrambling fruitlessly to try to derive this equation on the fly that they used. This is what you get when you don't prepare. You just try to wing it. So if I had, in other words, not read this far into the chapter, I wouldn't have, and I only read the beginning of the chapter, I would have tried this method and tried to derive this equation, R equals V naught squared over G times the sine of 2 theta. And I definitely failed. Sine of 2 theta. That's a function of So I just had to interpret it as this is a function of y. So the value, the vertical value, is a function of the sine of a certain degree. So far, the answer was 27 degrees. Let's pretend it was like right here. This is 180, and that's 360. Or no, that would be 360. So 0.14 is pi, so 2 pi, yeah. So 27, let's just say it was like that's 90, so 27's right there. So what that means is that from every time it repeats, there are two y values, or no, two x values that give you the same if where's our vowel thing? So if sine of our 2 times theta was this value, somewhere. so I guess maybe I'll make this the intro. This is going to be the most off-the-cuff video I've ever done, unprepared, which is saying a lot. So I couldn't stand that I didn't actually solve this problem. I did at the very end, but I couldn't do it alone. I had to reference this equation. And in order to get this equation, I tried fruitlessly on my own to derive it. But you needed a Drake identity and some nifty little algebraic